Bob Pompeani and Drew Fillipponi back with you, and this is our GMC Sierra tweet of the night. It comes from Pat Narduzzi, who knows this guy very well. Big congrats to Kenny Pickett on being named a captain. And yes, Andrew, it's interesting. Kenny Pickett is the captain, only one offensive captain. There remain two on defense, the usual two, and Cam Hayward and TJ Watt. And Miles Killebrew deserves to be that on special teams. A couple of years ago, it was Derek Watt. Before him, it was Dangerfield. But last year was Najee Harris and Mitch Trubisky. This year, it's just one in Kenny Pickett. Very interesting, isn't it?
Well, the Najee thing is because I kind of felt like Tomlin was grooming him to be a leader and to be like the face of that offense. I think I remember hearing him do a radio pregame interview saying that he looked at Najee Harris potentially as like a Cam Hayward type on the offensive side of the ball. And so to just strip it down to one guy and not keep it Kenny Pickett and Najee Harris is confounding to me. Because I feel like Mike Tomlin was building towards that, having Najee really assert himself in that way. So the fact that he isn't there, it forces me to read into that. Why would they change that? If you can have two defensive captains, why can't you have two offensive captains? If you make Kenny Pickett an offensive captain, it doesn't make him look bad if Najee's also a co-captain. Like, he can't do it on his own. So that's just weird to me. I don't know if he'll get asked that tomorrow at his press conference. If he does, he'll probably give a very short answer that isn't that really eye-opening. But I'm surprised by that, Bob, because I thought Mike Tomlin was looking at Najee Harris as like one of the faces of the Steelers' future.
Yeah, I had the same question, only because you could very easily just substitute Pickett for Trubisky. And that's it. And instead, he took him off of there all complete, which is – I don't know whose decision it actually is at the end. There's a lot of feedback by players, and every year it changes. There was a time I remember as many as six or seven captains on this team, including Jeff Reed once. He was a captain. So it just depends on the season, I suppose, and who you have available. Let's talk more about the Steelers and their offense. And I would expect the Steelers to not be as predictable as they were in the final nine games, which is run the ball, stay conservative, don't make a mistake. And it's good that you can run the ball, don't get me wrong. But I think it's time to take the layers of conservative football off of Kenny Pickett. And I would hope I see that early in the game, just like we did in the preseason. And if it doesn't work, I hope they stick to it and continue to go to it, because it's not going to work at some point. At some point, there's going to be an incompletion. At some point, there's going to be an interception when you try to go down the field to George Pickens. That doesn't mean you should shy away from it.
Yeah, I don't think that the offense is going to be run first. And I know that given the moves they made this year with the Sayamalu signing and the drafting of Broderick Jones and what they said coming out of the 2022 season, Art Rooney's comments about why he was optimistic because the way they ran the ball and the way the offensive line played in the second half of the season. I think Kenny played so well in training camp and in the preseason that I think they're going to go through him. And I think they're going to be an offense that believes in the quarterback and the weapons around him like they did with Roethlisberger in his prime to win games. That doesn't mean they abandon the run. We saw Ben with Le'Veon Bell, and they would give him the ball a lot. But, you know, this idea that the Steelers are going to copy last year's blueprint when they went 7-2 down the stretch and run the ball and play defense, Bob, I think they know they're better than that offensively. Mm-hmm. I think they know they don't have to play don't screw it up or mistake-free football. All last year we heard Matt Canada talk about the risks of offense and throwing to the middle of the field and not wanting to turn the ball over, and so many bad things can happen when you play that way. I think they only did that because it was a rookie, and I think this year we really see them open things up, and I expect them to average more than 24 points a game. No one got to 30 in the NFL last year, but I think they'll be one of the 10 highest scoring offenses in the league.
And that would be tremendous news for a defense that seemed to have been under a lot of pressure last year and trying to win games by themselves and not giving up touchdowns at critical points and be asked to stop big-time offenses. So that'll make life a lot easier and may increase the number of sacks and the number of turnovers the Steelers get on defense as well. By the way, I want to switch to college real quick. Duke is beating Clemson right now 19-7, and they're about to score again. Duke has a good quarterback, but I wasn't sure if they were able to deal with Clemson. Is Clemson a little overrated? Where they're, you know, you look at the rating, they're a top 10 team. you know, when I looked at their roster and some of the stuff I saw, I wasn't sure of it. Now I watch this game and I wonder what that means, not just to Clemson, but what does it mean now for the rest of the ACC? Because Pitt has to take on Duke. They don't play Clemson this year, but they also take on Florida State, which ran all over LSU yesterday.
Well, and that's the thing. As it turned out for Pitt, I don't think it was a great weekend, because the teams that are looking to become the class of the ACC, those teams look stronger than maybe I thought. I mean, these are ranked teams like North Carolina and Florida State. But the way North Carolina beat South Carolina, its rival, handily, a South Carolina team that beat Tennessee last year, scored some really big wins. South Carolina with Spencer Rattler, they went there and they beat them in a neutral site game, pretty good. And Florida State just blowing out a top 10 LSU team. And they've got a 6'8 receiver. They've got a wide receiver transfer from Michigan State, Coleman, who was excellent, two running backs. The quarterback has got a little Kenny Pickett vibe in him, where he's like 25 years old and still playing college football and looked really good in that game. And you mentioned Duke, Bob. They won 9 games last year, I believe. Mm-hmm. And that quarterback, Riley Leonard, is looked at as an NFL prospect. They got to go there the last week of the season. The more I think about it, if Pitt wins 8 games in the regular season and can get to 9 in the bowl game, I would say that's a good year for Pitt, even though it's Phil Jurkovic's only year at Pitt. And because of how he was recruited and how good he was in high school, you'd like them to win an ACC championship with him in his 1 year.
And it's now 21-7 Duke in the fourth quarter, 9 minutes left. Real quick before we go to break, I want to ask you about the Pirates. And I ask this only from the point of view that they've seemed to got some nice results from some of their guys who you'd be counting on to look at as next year starters. For example, Leover Peguero, I think 22, looks like he's going to be their second baseman. Cruz is coming back. The key thing is Hayes hit another home run and a triple tonight. He's going to win a gold glove. And if he gets this kind of consistency in his game offensively, I think they have something there. It makes me wonder what they're going to do with guys like Nick Gonzalez, Tamir Johnson, other guys they have who are infielders. They have a lot of infielders. And if one of them establishes like Peguero as the starter, other teams trade some of their guys, even though they're former number one picks. Do you ever see that happening with the Pirates?
Well, they should. I mean, maybe there's a team out there that looks at Henry Davis as a catcher, Bob.
Yeah.
If the Pirates don't. No, seriously. If the Pirates don't.
I agree with you.
And they can get a young pitcher or something like that for him, or a more natural outfielder, then do that. Or a first baseman. I mean, they've got to look into filling out a complete team next year. And so that means filling some of these holes, because we know they won't do it in free agency. That's asking too much of this team, unfortunately. And so I think you got to get creative like that. You've got to make baseball trades. The Hayes offensive production in the second half of the season, I think, is going to go down as the single biggest thing, positive thing, that happened for the Pirates this year. Because Keller's cooled off a little bit. The Cruz injury, obviously. Reynolds' extension was, good from a PR standpoint, but his numbers have been down. Sawinski hit a home run tonight, but has been so awful in the second half. If Hayes gives you this kind of offensive output, then that contract is a steal, because he is a great defensive player. And if he hits like this over a 162-game season, well, then you've got an all-star caliber third baseman for a long time.
Yeah, and there's no question about that. It's a contract that he'll maybe one day look at and say, I've outperformed it, which is exactly what a guy like Bosa's doing now with San Francisco. And I was looking to see if there's anything new. There isn't. We got to go to break, Andrew, but $17 million. $17.8 is what he's guaranteed this year on his fifth-year option. After that, he wants like $33 million a year, and that's going to set the record. And I imagine it's going to happen, but so far, nothing. We'll go to break and check it out. When we come back, we have more on the Ireland Contracting Nightly Sports Call on a Monday night in Pittsburgh.